The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Greetings, everyone. My name is Krista Brown. I'm training specialist with the APS Technical Assistance Resource Center, the APS TARC, and I want to welcome you to our webinar today, Equity and Cultural Humility in APS, beginning the conversation around staff and client experiences with Takai Ford, Adrena Tartt, and Sahar Takshi. And I'll be introducing our presenters in just a moment. Next slide. Before we get started, I'd like to share a little bit of information. This webinar is being hosted by the APS TARC, which is a project of the U.S. Administration for Community Living, Administration on Aging, Department of Health and Human Services, and administered by WRMA Incorporated. Contractors' findings, conclusions, and points of view do not necessarily represent the official policy of the federal government. Next slide. The APS TARC works with states to enhance the effectiveness of APS programs by working with partners on use of data and analytics, applying research and evaluation to practice, and encouraging the use of innovative practices and strategies. Essentially, we're here to help APS programs in any way we can. Just reach out to us using the contact information that will be displayed at the end of the webinar. Next slide. The APS TARC also presents monthly peer-to-peer calls. These calls provide a forum for workers, supervisors, and administrators to dialogue and share ideas with each other about the issues and concerns facing APS programs today. The calls are held the second, third, or fourth Wednesday of each month, depending on which peer group you identify with. Registration information is sent via the listserv each month, and email us if you want to be a part of the listserv and are not, and we'll help you get that registration information. Next slide. So on to some housekeeping. So handouts. I highly recommend that you check out the handout section of your webinar control panel. You will find today's slides, the vignettes, and two resource documents that have resources beyond what are in the slides today, and you won't want to miss those. All of these are available in the handout section of your webinar control panel, and you can download those at any time. Please also use your computer speakers to control your volume. If you are experiencing any kind of audio or broadband issues, we recommend that you sign out and log back into the presentation. Next slide. We're having plans to have questions at the end of the presentation, but at any point you can send in questions or comments to our presenters using the question box in your webinar control panel. And we also may be engaging you to send us some answers along the way. This presentation is being recorded and it'll be posted to the APS TARC website at a later date, and we will let you know when that is up, everybody who's registered, and a broader announcement. Everybody attending today will receive an email in approximately 24 hours with a link to download your certificate of attendance. And when prompted, be sure to take the brief evaluation survey. We really love to hear your feedback. And also just a quick reminder, this webinar is scheduled to run 90 minutes, and so that would be 3 to 4:30 Eastern time. Next slide, please. So now we're going to get a little sense of who we have with us today. So I'm going to launch a poll. Which of the following categories do you identify with the most? Are you an APS professional, a behavioral health professional, a medical professional, legal, or other? And we're going to collect those responses and then we will close the poll down in a few seconds. So go ahead and take a vote. They're coming in. All right, leave it open a couple more seconds, and then we will go ahead and close that and share the results. Okay, so the majority of folks today are APS professionals, and we have some others. If you want to go ahead and tell us what your other profession is in the questions box, that would be great. And we have legal and some behavioral health. So welcome, everybody. I'm going to go ahead and hide that poll. Next slide. So it is a great pleasure to introduce our presenters today. We've been getting to know each other over the last few months, and I've really, really appreciated working with them. Takai Ford is social work supervisor at the Jewish Association Serving the Aging for their Legal Social Work Elder Abuse Program, or also known as JASA LEAP, in Queens, New York City. Takai serves as a vital component in elder justice related issues, demonstrating her experience through staff training and her work with student scholars. We also have Adrena Tart, who is Special Populations Program Coordinator for Veterans, Older Adults, Human Trafficking, and Faith Communities in the Medical Director's Office of the Ohio Department of Mental Health and Addiction Services. Adrena also sits on a variety of statewide committees, including the Elder Abuse Commission, the Supreme Court on Adult Guardianship Subcommittee, and the Ohio Advisory Council for Aging. And then we have Sahar Takshi, who is staff attorney with Justice and Aging, where she is part of both the Equity and the National Center on Law and Elder Rights teams, and was a legal aid attorney before joining Justice and Aging. So I am going to turn my camera off and turn it on over to Takai to take it away.
Thank you, Krista, and thank you for this opportunity and this wonderful platform to discuss this amazing issue to address. So we're going to start off, next slide, we're going to start off with a poll just to take a temperature and do a little reflection in our own professional development. So the first poll question is, do you feel supported by your organization and their ability to give you what you need to perform your role? You can select one answer. I feel extremely supported. I feel supported, but could benefit from some changes in practice. I feel somewhat supported, but the majority of it is okay. I don't feel supported and things are not going to change.
Great.
And we'll give it a minute.
Yeah, we got some answers coming in.
Okay, Krista, whenever you want to end the poll, you can, and I will look at the results. So 32% say I feel extremely supported, 54% say I feel supported but could benefit from some changes in practice, and 8% say I feel somewhat supported but majority of it is okay, and 6% say that they don't feel supported. So we're going to follow that up with one more question, which is, do you feel at your organization's structure, leadership departments, do you feel represented based on your race, gender, and ethnicity, all intersectionalities? Yes, no, not sure, or maybe you haven't even thought about the subject. And take a minute to select. How are we doing on those responses, Krista?
We got about half of the folks on board.
Okay, we could give it another 30 seconds or so.
All righty. There you go.
Okay, so 70% of our participants say that they do feel that, you know, their organization structure reflects them, which is great to hear. No, 17% say no, 8% I'm not sure, and some, you know, are still trying to understand the, you know, the basis of the question and whether or not it's relative or important to their role. And I thank you for your participation. And we're just going to move on. Next slide. Okay, so I want everybody just to take a moment, and we're going to start off with a vignette or some information. And I want you to share your thoughts in the chat, and just have some ways of thinking about what questions that would come to mind. So APS receives an anonymous referral regarding a tall black male appearing to be in his late 60s or early 70s that has been seen walking the neighborhood and going into other residents' backyard. He is described as being aggressive when spoken to, having significant body odor, and stumbling when he walks as if he was intoxicated. It's reported he always returns to the same house, but no one seems to come in or out except for him on a consistent basis. The outside area of the home appears dirty, the grass hasn't been cut, and the mailbox is overfilled with mail. There's no other information about services or support. You are assigned this case in whatever role you're in. What are your first thoughts of approach? So we can move on to the next slide, and I want you guys to hold on to this information, because everything that we're going to be discussing is going to tie into this vignette. So my next poll question is, which word best describes fairness? Equality, equity, or both equality and equity? Take a minute and select. And Krista, at any time, you can share the results once you think that everyone has had a moment to select
their
response.
Okay, we're at about 60%. I'm going to go ahead and close and share those.
All right. So 8% say equality, 38% say equity, and about 53% say both equality and equity. So the response is usually equity. And, you know, we will go into further discussion throughout our webinar presentation about why it's best described as fairness. We were going to go on to one more poll question, and equity is treating people equally, giving each person according to their needs, treating people fairly, or all of the above. Please take a moment and select a response.
So, Takai, while we are waiting for responses to come in, we did have a couple of people share about the referral. One said, sounds like some self-neglect, maybe an inability to maintain housekeeping. I think I would go in and assess. And another response was follow guidelines, going to the front door first.
Those are great, amazing responses and thoughts of how to approach this particular case.
All right.
Thank you for sharing.
No problem.
We could end the poll and see what our responses are.
All right. And let me share those results with you. There you go.
All righty. So 2% said treating people equally, 48% said giving each person according to their needs, 4% said treating people fairly, and 46% said all of the above. So the answer is giving each person according to their needs in regards to the definition of equity. And can we go back to that image, Krista, that was on the last line? So this is a image that depicts the difference between equality and equity. As you see, everyone has the ability to get on a bicycle, but everyone's needs are different and to meet it. And I'm going to pass this on to Adrena, who is going to touch on the importance of looking through a lens of equity. Adrena, take it away.
Thank you, Takai. Next slide, please. So in my part of the presentation, I'm going to talk about a little bit about the mental health and behavioral health frame as we're looking at health equity and health disparity. Before we get started, though, I just wanted to kind of share a little bit more about myself. So Krista had shared that I am currently employed with the Ohio Department of Mental Health and Addiction Services. I've enjoyed my career immensely. Before coming to the department, I was a provider for quite a while, over 20 years. And I am a licensed social worker as well as a chemical dependency practitioner. I also wanted to point out that I have lived experience with a family member who had been diagnosed with a mental health illness, and also a mother who had suffered dementia, and I was the primary caregiver for 15 years. And both of my parents really added value to my worldview in terms of my social work practice. So I wanted to just kind of mention that as I navigate through these slides. So when we talk about health equity, within behavioral health, we're talking about an opportunity to be healthy as possible. However, we also need to really speak to those individuals that may have some social and economic and environmental influences that make their life more challenging and bring exposure to problems within their health situation. So health disparities is the differences in health outcomes and their causes amongst groups of people. Behavioral health disparity, we generally find that there is more of a high population of persons in communities of color that have had these social, economic, and environmental challenges influencing their conditions. Next slide, please. So some of the issues when we are trying to serve folks with mental health challenges within our systems, we generally are met with a lot of biases when it comes around to a person with mental health challenges. And sometimes it may be fear, but those biases impact the ability for those populations to be served well. We also look at bias in terms of an implicit bias. These are subconscious hidden biases that you may not know that are there. And sometimes people operate in our various systems serving folks with mental health challenges where these are really influences the outcomes of service to individuals and families. When we look at ageism, there are times when individuals that are aged are invisible. They have and when I talk about invisible, meaning that they may not have a priority of service. We may have a problem within a behavioral health system that does not have services to serve aging persons. Geriatricians are lacking. Those individuals that have experience serving our older adult populations with psychiatric needs and so forth. So ageism is alive and well, and that does impact a mental health outcome with individuals. And of course, stigma of what mental health looks like. There's a fear about serving people with mental health issues. We may see that sometimes when we're trying to get people in hospitals. There may be some hospitals that don't feel like they can really serve certain types of mental health illnesses and have to rely on our public system hospitals. So there's a lot of stigma around what mental health and addiction is and person's comfort level with it. Cultural factors, we have a lot of various diverse cultures, new Americans, we have a lot of cultures that have come from wars and are traumatized, and sometimes they bring forth psychiatric illnesses and they're more pronounced. So cultural practices and families generally are more supportive with their family members going into these systems, and our policies may not be welcoming to serve the individuals the way that is more conducive to support. So there are a lot of cultural issues when it comes to mental health services that we have to consider. And just the lifetime effect of health equities. When we're talking about substance use and we're talking about mental health, where people may be homeless, there may be just pronounced impacts of people's physical bodies, trying to get them into health, adequate health care to support their bodies and their physical care is challenging and does have a pronounced impact on their physical care and lifetime. So we find that a lot of people with mental health and addiction services do not live as long. Next slide, please. So a pathway to our behavioral health equity outcomes are addressing those health disparities, really looking at some of our cultural and linguistic competency approaches to reducing those disparities. Within our workforce, are we reflective of the people that are coming through the doors? If we have new Americans, are the workforce reflective of those new Americans that can bring forth a commonality and understanding of traditions and belief patterns and so forth? And then moving to reducing some of those disparities, trying to address all of those barriers that really are in the way of people getting well. And then as a result, having a behavioral health equity system. Next slide, please. And looking at approaches to reduce behavioral health disparities when we talk about system transformation, we're looking at something that's going to be sustainable. And so we want to look at assessment of what our systems really look like. So the systems that we had for time in earlier years may not be adequate for what the population reflects today. So we want to look at assessment, and what kinds of things that we need to adjust and enhance within our various types of systems, the capacity, do we have the capacity to serve the populations that we see? Planning is very important as we work across systems to bring various types of systems to the table, to be involved in the planning, especially communities of color and other populations that we're serving to reflect those people coming into our organizations. And doing an implementation and then that evaluation. Next slide, please. So do you believe you are culturally competent in your practice? That is a poll. If you could go ahead and answer that question.
All right, the poll is launched and we have some answers coming in. All right, give it a few more seconds. Go ahead and cast that vote. All right, I'm gonna close and share.
Okay, so 39% of you say yes, and 18% say no. And 43% says it's a trick question. Next slide, please. Okay, so when we talk about cultural competence, we're really talking about a learning of other cultures. We're talking about addressing biases, adapting some of those behavior and communication pieces that may interact with others, and trying to enhance that communication and behavior. But it's an ongoing learning experience. It's not really a static kind of experience. So it's a lifelong learning. That's how we view cultural competency. So we're always going to be needing to learn new things, new ways that people are, how they present themselves and so forth. So we are going to look at now cultural humility, which, next slide please, which we really look at recognizing the uniqueness of individuals. It's not really focused on just group traits or, you know, particular meals that people eat or, you know, particular holidays and how they celebrate them or their countries of origin. It's more of, well, we'll get to that in the next slide. It's not really a defined course or curriculum, and it's focused on achieving competence or expertise. It's not a static goal. It's an ongoing process. Next slide. So when we talk about cultural humility, we're focused on the individual. It's very person-centered. We're looking at in giving opportunity to attend to a person's gender, their country of origin, their sexual orientation. It's also a life learning process, and it's being more flexible with a humility. Next slide. So we approach cultural humility more open, being more self-aware and reflective of ourselves, and being more supportive, less egotistical, and more receiving of who's in front of us and listening with sensitivity. Next slide. And the outcomes then are more mutual, and we are able to establish partnerships, more respect, more optimal care, and it's an ongoing lifelong experience. The next slide. So where do we go from here? We turn inward and we identify and consider aspects of cultural identity and lived experience from others. We're listening to others and their experiences and appreciating them. We're considering the privilege and the power dynamic that we may approach a situation with. We are doing a lot of reflection with our own biases and assumptions and attitudes that we come with. And we commit to self-evaluation and a self-critique. Next slide. And as we are looking outward, we are looking at clinical care integration, with initiatives to address structural factors. We're doing improvements in access to treatment. And these are things that I think that is very important to work with systems, across systems, other systems, because all of our human service delivery systems have their own language, have their own discipline in the way that they do their work. And in order to really serve people well, we have to learn those other systems and work with those other systems, invite them into a partnership with you as you do your service delivery, and leverage how you all can serve communities of color or marginalized persons effectively. The class standards are something that looks at a governance of an organization where you can provide that internal organization with appropriate policies, workforce that's reflective of the community that you're serving, and engage people from the community in the organizational structure in that manner. The class standards kind of give you a roadmap on how to do that. And then of course, workforce development, making sure that our organizations definitely reflect the people we serve, the communities that we're in. Next slide, please. And here is just some resources that I think are very valuable for this conversation that we're having. The Kerwin Institute has some wonderful modules on implicit bias training that I would say is worthwhile taking a look at. I think that the preference-based living cards that kind of look at person-centered care, really honing into the uniqueness of an individual and all of their gifts and culture and the ways that they live out in their world. It's really a nice way of being able to capture some of those qualities from individuals that we're serving. And so I will hand it off to back to Takai. Thanks to Takai.
Thank you, Adrena, for all of that rich content that you just shared with us. And we are going to move on to the next slide. So I want everyone to take a moment and imagine this person while I read. Mr. G is an 86-year-old Black male who migrated from a small island in the West Indies to the United States in the late 1960s. He was a police officer in his native country and valued being of service. Mr. G's access to education was limited, but his ability to absorb information was extraordinary. He faced a lot of adversities in his lifetime, the biggest one being that the color of his skin deterred him from opportunities, more so than being from a foreign country. His determination to overcome that obstacle motivated him. Mr. G was able to move his wife and son to the United States. He was able to purchase a home in the late 1970s, working as a state employee for many years. Mr. G retired to take care of his ill wife and became her primary caregiver. His passion in retirement was gardening, bringing his ideologies of cultivating the land. He would grow many herbs and brew natural remedies for pain, colds, stress. His philosophy was, why do you think they call it a medical practice? Because they haven't yet figured it out, so they practice on you. He was meticulous, a man of routine, and guarded his ability to be independent like a fortress, never accepting help or asking for it from anyone. He believed that you become stronger when you figure things out on your own. Next slide. About 15 years ago, Mr. G started to show signs of memory loss. He started to forget his way home, forgot to pay his expenses, and misplacing money. His son managed to convince him to see a neurologist who confirmed he had dementia. Mr. G allowed his son to assist with maintaining his finances, but only if he wouldn't disclose his diagnosis to anyone, not even his wife. His son kept his secret all the way until his unfortunate passing in 2014. Impacted by the grief and loss of his son, Mr. G started to deteriorate quickly. He began leaving his home at odd hours of the night, forgetting if he ate or if he showered. He neglected his wife's need for assistance. He got into disputes with other family members and began isolating himself from the ones he loved. He even lost the ability to take care of his garden. A couple who moved into the neighborhood recently noticed Mr. G and his activities and behavior. Concerned for their family's safety and possible retaliation, they anonymously reported Mr. G to APS. With that context, I want you guys to take a moment to think about how would you still consider the same approach from the initial beginning of the vignette, or would you change it? You can add your comments in the chat as well. And I'm going to pass this along while you guys reflect on your on the vignette to Sahar.
Thank you, Takai. And as was mentioned earlier, my name is Sahar Takshi. I work at Justice and Aging, and I'm really excited to talk to you all today about equity from the legal perspective and also more generally about equity and aging. Can we move to the next slide, please? So first, I want to emphasize that it's important for us to recognize that the impacts of disparities like racism, sexism, homophobia, and otherwise, they can both magnify and change throughout the course of one's life. So they can look different for an older adult than they would for a younger person. And a really clear example of this is that research has shown us that experiences of racism increases our risk of developing chronic illness. And you can imagine how an older adult might have had more of those experiences and therefore greater risk. But what about an example of how a disparate impact can look different at a different point in life? Well, we know that racial discrimination leads to higher rates of incarceration for young Black men and women, but the collateral consequences of incarceration can follow an individual later on in life too. For example, in the form of barriers to accessing housing after the person is released from incarceration. And another example is how these disparities can present themselves differently for older adults is how discrimination in the workplace and gender wage gaps can become a barrier in the ability to save for retirement at an older age. Next slide, please. So in all of those examples, we actually touched on two forms of disparities combined. One of those was associated with age, and another was associated with some other demographic factor like race or gender. And what we call that is intersectionality. And that's the existence of multiple personal identities, such as by race, sexual orientation, gender identity, immigration status, or disability. So as we're working to center our work in equity, we need to recognize that oppression can exist on the basis of intersecting identities. For example, on the basis of age and race, or age and disability, or all three. It's important to recognize that the people with intersecting identities have higher possibilities of experiencing oppression. And oftentimes those oppressions can look different than they might look for each of those identities on their own. Next slide, please. Okay, I don't want to bore everyone with too much legal talk today, but I did want to touch on a couple of cases that I hope can demonstrate the importance of discussing and addressing intersectionality. So one example of how intersectionality has been handled in the law is the case of Graffenried versus General Motors. And that's a case that was decided in 1976. But there, five Black women had sued General Motors due to a layoff policy that targeted Black women in particular. And that was because General Motors did not hire Black women before 1964. And so during the subsequent seniority-based layoffs, the company ultimately exclusively fired Black women. But the court in that case did not combine the racial discrimination and the sexual discrimination claims together. And it justified not doing that by saying that Title VII of the Civil Rights Act did not consider Black women to be a protected class on their own. Scholars like Professor Kimberly Crenshaw, who's a notable activist in this space, has noted that this type of legal analysis ignores that women of color have a unique intersectional experience that neither men of color nor white women can relate to. I also want to note that in a separate case, Payne versus Travernell, which was decided that same year, that case came to the opposite conclusion. In that case, two Black women had brought a class action against their employer on behalf of all the Black employees, but the court granted the employer's request to bar the class from including Black men, so it only looked at the effect on Black women. And so you can really clearly see that contradiction where in General Motors, the plaintiffs were not allowed to advocate solely for Black women, but in Travernell, they were forced to. And both times it was to the disadvantage of what they were trying to achieve. And so these cases and a patchwork of others since then can demonstrate why it's so important for us to talk about intersectionality and understand what it really means, and then be intentional about the way we approach disparities going forward. Next slide, please. Okay, so we've talked about how disparities can magnify or alter across the age spectrum, and how those disparities intersect with identities like race and gender identity. But how do we conceptualize these themes in practice? Where do they come up? Well, one place you'll see this discussed is in the Older Americans Act. So it's actually a requirement for limited program and service resources to target their services to older adults who have the greatest economic or social need. And the term greatest social need is defined to include things like physical and mental disabilities, language barriers, and cultural, social, or geographic isolation, including isolation that's related to race or ethnicity. So a lot of the partners that APS can work with, including legal services or area agencies on aging, do have this federal requirement to focus on specific populations that have been historically marginalized. There are also a whole host of other federal and state laws that you might kind of interact with in your work without really even realizing it, that have similar intentions to focus on prohibiting discrimination against systemically marginalized populations. For example, if you ever work with a healthcare worker, the Affordable Care Act might apply, and that prohibits discriminating on the basis of race, age, disability, or sex. Similarly, if you've ever had to work with a housing provider or a landlord, they're also barred from discriminating under the Fair Housing Act. Next slide, please. But, you know, a lot of the time you won't see something clearly spelled out in the law that says you have to target services to historically and systemically marginalized populations. But you can look a lot deeper beneath the surface of the issues or the text that you see in your daily work and see that equity is an integral part of achieving the goals of any social program. And so I just want to provide an example of what I really mean by that. And I use Maryland for this example because I used to live in Montgomery County. And the APS statute in Maryland calls the service population vulnerable adults, and then defines that to mean someone who lacks the physical or mental capacity to provide for the adult's daily needs. So let's think a little deeper about what that means and how you might apply it to a person utilizing APS services. So surely a person who has faced discrimination in the health sphere, for example, due to their race or sexual orientation, or hasn't had access to reliable health coverage due to systemic disparities, they might now be in a position in later life where they cannot provide for their daily needs. Similarly, something like access to appropriate housing, one that is safe and affordable, that has the right modifications, that's in a neighborhood that is accessible to the individual, both in terms of its infrastructure and its accessibility to public resources, that can all affect whether a person has the ability to provide for their daily needs. And those are just a few examples of how systemic inequities across all sectors can contribute to whether someone is a vulnerable adult later in life. And I'm sure you can think of many other disparities that you've seen in your work. For example, inequities in economic security or in the criminal legal system that have similar impacts. Next slide, please. So individuals who have faced elder abuse, whether it's in the form of financial abuse or emotional, sexual, or physical abuse, may be hesitant to report these incidents. So similarly, systemic discrimination and experiencing disparities not only impact whether a person may later need assistance as an older adult, but it can also affect whether and how a person utilizes that assistance later in life. So whether a person themselves has experienced discrimination, or whether that community at large faces discrimination or disparities, for example, in the health sector, it might make them hesitant to seek help, to report abuse, or to accept services. And we know that elder abuse is often perpetrated by someone close to the individual, and that can create an additional barrier for reporting for similar reasons. Next slide, please. So on the previous slide, I mentioned how experiencing elder abuse or systemic discrimination might make someone hesitant to report an incident. And those experiences might also be a form of trauma for the individual. And this includes racial trauma. So some of you may have heard of trauma-informed practices in your work. And these are practices that aim to reduce re-traumatization and recognize the role that all trauma plays in your relationship with the client. Next slide, please. And these trauma-informed practices involve identifying that trauma and making changes to your relationship with the client in relation to that trauma. So I've linked a resource here that was shared with me, but I want to talk to you about a few ways that equity might play a role in your trauma-informed practice. First is acknowledging that trauma can arise from discrimination, including from racism, experiencing sexism or homophobia, or other forms of discrimination. And that adjusting your client relationship in relation to this type of trauma requires you to be attentive to what your client is and isn't comfortable with. And that kind of relates back to the cultural competence that Adrena was talking about earlier. And the second way is that vicarious trauma or secondary trauma that you might experience as a professional who works directly with clients who themselves have trauma can be viewed from an equity lens as well. And that's because when we experience secondary trauma, we naturally find ways to cope. And if we're not mindful of it, we may cope by relying on service rationing behaviors, which is when we focus our attention on clients who we view as being compliant, as opposed to clients who we view as being difficult or incredulous, which of course has inequitable implications for clients who are hesitant to accept assistance due to their personal experiences or systemic disparities. Next slide, please. So what are some ways we can center equity in our day-to-day work and avoid those service rationing behaviors that have inequitable impacts? Well, one way is to practice cultural responsiveness, which we've also heard called cultural competence or cultural humility. That's defined, as Adrena was talking about, it involves embracing the principles of equal access and non-discriminatory practice in service delivery. And it can be done in many ways, like we've talked about, but part of it can include getting educated about systemic barriers, engaging directly with impacted communities, revising policies and practices so that they align with your equity goals, and recognizing your own implicit biases. Next slide. Implicit biases, which we've mentioned a few times now, are attitudes towards groups of people and stereotypes that affect our reasoning without our conscious knowledge. So these are different from explicit biases, which are those negative attitudes that people know and choose to have. It's really important to realize that implicit biases exist even when we have no explicit biases. And so countering implicit bias requires us to first identify it and then take steps to mitigate it. And I've linked a few resources here, including the implicit bias test that Adrena had linked earlier, and another resource on applying this to cultural competent practices. And I believe we have a poll question coming up now. Okay, so the poll question reads, have you thought about implicit bias in your work? And this is a select all that apply. The options are, I have taken implicit bias tests, I have attended implicit bias trainings, I may have implicit bias, but I have not accessed any resources, or I do not believe I have implicit biases. We could take a minute to respond to these.
Yes, responses are coming in.
Okay. Give it maybe just a couple more seconds and we can show the responses.
Sure. We're almost at about half of the people voting. Okay. All right. I'm going to go ahead and close that and share. Here you go.
Okay, great. The majority of people have said they attended implicit bias trainings, and I'm really glad to hear that. I would love to hear what kind of trainings you've attended. 38% of people have taken an implicit bias test. Like I mentioned, that's been linked in the presentation. 13% of people recognize that they may have implicit bias but have not accessed any resources, and about 10% said that they don't believe they have any implicit biases. So as we mentioned, implicit biases are those that exist without our conscious knowledge. So taking those tests and accessing those resources can maybe help recognize some of them. Next slide, please. All right, last few slides here. So we've touched on the concept of being attentive to what clients are comfortable with as a result of their experiences, which I would view as being part of person-centered services. And that's focusing on your client's wishes as opposed to what you believe is in their best interest. And recognizing that those preferences can be affected by their own experiences that are completely different than your own, including cultural or community-based experiences. Next slide, please. Right, and I want to quickly just share a few resources from Justice and Aging, the first being our internal strategic framework to advance equity. So last year, our organization created the strategy to center our work on behalf of low-income older adults in equity, and we identified how we would do this through the six elements of our work. I've linked that here if you're interested in taking a look at it through our website. Next slide, please. And part of that centering on equity resulted in creating an equity toolkit, which is available online. The toolkit contains trainings, resources, articles, and other materials about equity, and specifically equity for older adults from Justice and Aging, as well as materials from the National Center on Law and Elder Rights and some of our other partners. This is an ever-evolving webpage. We're still building it out, but you're always welcome to look through it if you're interested in reading more. And my and my colleagues' emails are available through that link as well if you have any questions. Next slide, please. Okay, and lastly for me, I wanted to link a few other resources that I thought you might find useful to look through after this presentation. The Equity Toolkit is linked again, as well as some resources from the National Center on Law and Elder Rights, and this guide from the Massachusetts Healthy Aging Collaborative. I just found it useful to peruse through to think about how systemically they've been looking at these issues and addressing it from lots of different angles. And I thought you might find that interesting as well. But thank you, everyone, and I will turn it back to Takai.
Hi, everyone. So we got a lot of information, right? We've been talking about racial trauma, right? Systemic discrimination, equity, health disparities that affect equitable practices, right? Being self-aware, you know, through cultural humility, having the understanding to be open to learn and evolve in thought. Implicit bias, we all have them, being aware of them to enact change and then apply it in our practices. It is a lot of rich information that we will be doing, and the practice of all of that is day in and day out in our personal and our professional development. So we're going to go on to the next slide. And we are going to go back to the vignette and talk about the part where APS becomes involved, right? So APS went to visit the referral they received. They went to investigate the referral they received. As a procedure, if indicated that the person may be aggressive, it is common to go with law enforcement or additional workers to ensure the safety of everyone. Mr. G was immediately defensive and angry when he saw law enforcement and APS at his front door. He demanded the APS worker leave his property, saying he didn't need any help. And since we have a lot of adult protective services, I'm pretty sure many of you may have experienced that through your career. The assigned worker saw Mr. G's wife, who appeared anxious during the encounter. While Mr. G was yelling, the APS worker also took note of the condition of the home and noticed a picture of a Caribbean island, and underneath it, it said, "Love and Pride." The worker apologized to Mr. G for upsetting him, by coming unannounced and asked him if he wouldn't mind answering something. Mr. G agreed. He asked Mr. G if he was from the Caribbean. And Mr. G answered and said that he was. The APS worker then engaged Mr. G by discussing the Caribbean and the beauty of the islands. The worker was eventually invited into the home and asked Mr. G if it was okay for the police officers to come in and the other worker. Mr. G said yes and stated, "I was a police officer in my country." He spoke about his value of being of service and his pride and family, including names. Mr. G's wife felt a little more at ease to provide context, explaining that their son had passed away and a distant family friend stopped coming because of Mr. G's temper at times. Next slide. The workers assessed that Mr. G's temperament shifted recently. His wife described him as a gentle giant. The police officers asked her if she was afraid of him. She replied, "No, I'm not afraid of him. I'm afraid for him. He's not himself." Their deceased son had a daughter who would call and check on them periodically. She was in college. Mr. G's wife gave the APS worker permission to reach out to her to discuss what was going on. The worker called the granddaughter in front of Mr. G and his wife. The worker explained to the granddaughter about the APS referral they received. The granddaughter was able to rule out of any issues with alcohol or drugs and was stated in the referral. She further explained that she knows that they both take medication but wasn't sure what for. She explained that she hasn't seen them in a long time because she was finishing school, and they always say everything was fine when they speak over the phone. Following the visit, the APS worker was able to implement services, including the client and their granddaughter every step of the way. The APS worker learned more about Mr. G on his visit, what he liked, how he was when he was in his younger days, as well as the implications of the dementia. The worker focused on making sure that service delivery aligned with Mr. G's values. So with that, I wanted to share, right? The APS worker just took a moment in time and just said, "Let me take a step back," because the purpose and the goals is making sure that this vulnerable adult had everything that they needed and not to cause more harm. And was able to utilize the things that the client valued, right? His country, his native land, right? Having the respect of asking questions, right? Apologizing when the intent wasn't malice, right? You're just doing your job. You're going to respond to a referral. But even when it causes some harm, having that moment of saying, "You know, I apologize," and reflecting on what practices could be done. This vignette actually is about my grandfather, who recently passed away and was experiencing the signs of dementia. My father had passed in 2014 suddenly, and due to the work of this worker, I was able to step in as a caregiver once I was aware of the situation. And due to his efforts of involving me, as well as approaching in a way that kept my grandfather's dignity as a police officer, as an independent person all of his life, allowed the transition of care to go as smoothly as possible. And we can go on to the next slide. So this is the time for questions, comments, concerns, and I think we can allow the rest of the panelists to join us at this time.
Yes, please. Takai, I have a quick question for you as we're waiting for folks to send in their questions. How did things change for your grandmother?
For my grandmother, it changed because I became the caregiver for both of them, right? Okay. But she felt comfortable once the worker was able to come into the home. Once she saw that my grandfather's demeanor had changed during that incident, she was willing to share a little bit more. Culturally, you know, they're very private. It's keeping things in the family. And although my grandfather at the time, because of his Alzheimer's and dementia, tried to isolate those around him because in fear of them knowing what was happening. And her not having the knowledge or the signs of what Alzheimer's looks like, she felt more safe. So as discussed about elder abuse, there sometimes they talk about neglect, passive and active. Active means you know what you're doing and you're actively neglecting the person that you're supposed to care for. In my grandfather's case, it was passive. He did not know. He was having these signs and wanted his pride, didn't want to share with anyone because of his independence. But allowing him to be a part of it every step of the way made it easier for me and my sister to step in when she became older and old enough, even to last year when he passed away in September. You know, one of the things that he did share with me that I always, always talk about when it comes to this disease, he said, you know, I've given and I've been of service all my life. I've been, you know, a good person, you know, and he was a very spiritual person and he believed in God. And he said, you know, out of all the things I could get, why would God want me to forget who I am? And so my answer to him was always for us to remember who you are. And so, you know, he died with dignity and respect and was cared for. My grandmother is currently 95 and she's currently cared for and still is in full cognitive function, and was the result of why I went into the field that I did of social work with a concentration of working with older adults, because everyone deserves dignity and older adults definitely deserve quality life, no matter if there's a cognitive decline, if there is any issue. And systems and structures do depict the care that we can give, but us as advocates and professionals, we can make the change.
Thank you. Thank you. So at this point in time, we have lots of time for questions. It's the rare time that we have legal and behavioral health and APS all in one panel. So please take advantage of that. And while we're waiting for folks' questions to come in, Sahar, you brought up an interesting concept, and this is something that had just come in up in another conversation I had recently, which is the concept of rationing behavior, so service rationing behavior. And I wondered if you wanted to talk about that a little more. And then, Takai, as a APS supervisor, have you ever encountered that with your workers in a way that is just not intentional, but may be more workload burnout related? So first, Sahar, is there anything else you want to say about service rationing behaviors, and then punt it over to Kai?
Sure. Yeah, I think service rationing behaviors, I think, are something that anyone can experience, honestly, in any industry that works directly with clients. So whether you're an attorney, a medical professional, or an APS, there's this coping mechanism that is really common in these industries where you're dealing with individuals who have faced traumas. And service rationing behaviors, like I mentioned before, are when we choose to focus our attention on the clients who we view as being easier to work with, often because they're compliant, as opposed to those clients who are maybe more hesitant or we might think they're being difficult. And service rationing is, of course, unethical work, right? We are not helping our clients equally. And in fact, we're often not helping the clients who maybe have the deepest rooted issues, right? So I think the root of service rationing behaviors often comes from the sense of feeling unsupported at work, feelings of burnout, feeling like we don't have the managerial support behind us to address whatever it is we're facing at work. So I think a lot of the root of that can obviously come from self-care, but also having support from your organization, from your teammates, your supervisors is really important to combat that and have that organizational culture that values sustainability in your work so you can help clients equally across the board.
Thank you.
So it is a real thing, right? And sometimes it's done, as Sahar said, sometimes it's done unconsciously. With the population that I serve, we deal with clients who are experiencing victimization of mistreatment, and you know, and with the older adult population. And one of the practices that we try to do here at JASA, collectively as a team, is talk about cases together, feelings that we may have, so that we can decipher what is what I'm feeling internally, what is the need for the client, right? So although we have a structure of policy and procedures of moving forward with clients that are experiencing mistreatment, and you know, the compliance of deadlines and things of that nature and the pressures of that can be quite daunting and overwhelming, for us to give support and advocate for our clients, we have to feel supported. And so as a group and collectively, we share ideas, we share thoughts about clients that and finding ways of approaching that. In New York City, we have multidisciplinary teams. So it's a host of social workers, medical professionals, you know, general psychologists, all sitting around talking about a complex case, right? And how we can support each other to address all of the issues for this particular client, right? And it's a way for us to say, this has been difficult for me, these are the approaches that I did, right? Where you're attaching the emotions that you feel, because you are a person. You're gonna feel what you feel, and I think you should have a right to, but it shouldn't impact in your practice. And so it's always understanding the balance of that. And so we try to make sure that we're respecting each other's feelings, but also understanding where they come from. And as mentioned before about vicarious trauma, being very in tune with your feelings, being very in tune of what you hear and your responses definitely dictates in your practice. And so you have to have space for that, right? A safe psychological space for that, even as a professional. And that is all the way from your supervisor to your team, to your administration. That is a necessary for you to be able to go out there and make sure that you are advocating and doing best practices with your clients. I definitely utilize the saying that you hear on, you know, on airplanes all the time, you have to put the oxygen mask over yourself before you can assist anyone else. And I think we have to apply that in life. Sometimes we need to reflect and make sure that we are supported, we have what we need so that we could then support.
Great, thank you. Adrina, any comments in your experience?
Yes. So I wanted to just thank Takai for that sharing of the story of her grandfather. That was wonderful. I would like to take an opportunity, though, and say if we were to look at that case of Mr. G from a different lens. So we get a complaint from someone in the neighborhood. And this traditionally happens. You call in, whether it's APS or law enforcement, and there's a person that's walking around suspiciously. It appeared that they were angry and they were talking, you know, in various ways or what have you. From a mental health lens, if a person would have demonstrated those type of behaviors, the law enforcement may have picked them up and took them to a crisis station. At the crisis station, there would be some sort of evaluation, but it might have escalated Mr. G. So you may have a more of a problem engagement that the crisis station is looking at, and that situation may have turned into a different kind of path for Mr. G. He might have been given a 24-hour period within a particular location. if he was upset, it might have just made more of a stubbornness or not wanting to comply with whatever the system was saying, which then makes the system then do other things. So we don't know if it could have been hospitalized, could have been sent to the ER for more evaluation, possibly looking at medical clearance. You know, so we sometimes as systems respond to the community in different ways that maybe those issues of looking at our biases and the implicit kind of reactionary ways that we manage situations that way, and it turns out to be something different for the people that we serve. So I just wanted to bring that point out to say that sometimes depending on the individuals in the systems involved, sometimes it can be more harm than Mr. G's case that Takai presented on.
I agree with you, Adrena. I definitely agree with you as far as it was stated early in the vignette, this was a man that believed in cultivating and not relying on the medical profession, right? He migrated from his country to the United States and thought that his biggest adversity would be being from another country, but it was the first time that he was faced with racism and the systems of racism, right? In his country, he was proud of serving the law, but his experiences in the United States with law enforcement differed, right? And he understanding and molding and adapting to those circumstances throughout an entire lifespan, you know, those are things that we have to consider, right? That may not be stated in a referral, that may not be given. And I think it's definitely important that although these systems are here to protect, safeguard, have practices of doing good, there are some things that work, don't work, or need to be innovated or looked at. We always have to look at, measuring outcomes of success and goals, and they're going to be different. It doesn't matter if you've been in your profession or in your role for 20 years, 15 years, 30 years. There's always room for learning. There's always room for evolvement. The reason why we are able to make mistakes is so that we can grow and evolve and learn, right? So even in our practice, we take courses, we're sitting on this webinar to learn. And I think that approaches are going to be different, and there's just going to be a lot of questions and content that you may need, right? The moment that worker just said, okay, while he's screaming, let me just look around. Mm-hmm. Okay, I see that there's this thing on his wall, even though the house was in total chaos, that appeared to be very important to him. I see another vulnerable adult here not speaking, but appearing scared. Now, it could have gone differently. They could have sent law enforcement in there, which could have escalated the situation. His simple apology in that moment allowed that person's defenses to calm down and allowed a form of communication. And I think that we have to assess that each and every day.
Mm-hmm. Takai, a question came in around what legal avenues did you have to take control of your grandparents' care?
So one was applying for guardianship. Luckily enough, it wasn't very difficult, only as far as like maintaining his financial expenses and affairs and things of that nature, because my grandfather was very proactive and he did see an attorney on his own many, many years ago. We just wanted to make sure that everything was up to date, and that we wouldn't have had any issues moving forward, especially when he would become combative, especially as he declined with the disease. As he was depicted as this gentle giant, he was, you know, even as a caregiver, which can be a lot, right? And I had to have 5 moments of self-care and finding my own ways of support as well, and while maintaining their quality of life and their autonomy and how they live. And it is definitely a lot to learn. And I bring those practices in my profession. So although they're in my personal life, it has definitely been to the betterment of my growth in my career as far as working with older adults. And we wanted to make sure that everything was binding. It was what they wanted. My grandmother had conversations with him at the early onset of his dementia. My father did have some things in place before his passing. And so it was an easier transition than most. I realized the importance of advanced directives with older adults, right? We never know, you know, when our clock is up, and we want to make sure that our wishes are carried out no matter what. And understanding the difference and approaching that is crucial. But sitting down and making sure that they understand, even to this day, although I'm financially responsible and I pay all the bills for my grandmother, I sit down there, show her what the bill is, write out the check, because it's important. Just because I'm assisting in her care doesn't mean that she doesn't have a right to say or know what is going on as a caregiver.
Great. And so we have a couple minutes for one more question, and this is, again, supervisor related. What is the role of the supervisor in addressing bias, particularly potential implicit bias, when doing case reviews in APS?
So you always want to make sure that you are leaving room for conversation, and starting with questions, right? So if someone starts with an approach, right, and you think it's an implicit bias that is occurring, ask them why. What was the reason why you approached it this way, right? Alongside understanding and paying attention and being very well aware of their caseloads, right? The complexity of their cases, the need, the resources, the time, right? And approaching it in a way that allows room for them to say what they may need in that moment as a caseworker, while giving instruction that is warm, welcoming, but an ability to learn. You know, my work with my students is always to tell them, listen, in social work, I'm still learning, right? And even though they're students, every day I learn something new. Every day, you know, I offer support, I ask for support, I've learned to advocate for myself, and you're going to be doing it throughout your career. And I think it's important to make sure that caseworkers understand those parameters. Yes, they have a job to do. The only way that they are able to do that is if they feel that they're supported. And we can't make every change, right? You know, from a legislation level or a policy level, you know, and how it trickles down. But we can empathize with those implications. We could advocate for those needs when we have those moments and times to speak up and say, hey, you know, my workers need this. We need this. We need to look at this and measure this and see what's going on. And also just doing a temperature check, I think is always important, but allowing them to see what their approach was while guiding them and giving instruction of how they can do something differently. I never tried to use right or wrong. I said, what could have been done differently, right? Language is very important when communicating and giving constructive feedback.
Great. Well, thank you so much. Thank you for all of your questions. We're not able to get to every one of them. And if it's something that I can reply to, or I will work with our presenters to get back to you if we didn't address it. But thank you. I want to thank you so much to Kai and Sahar and Adrina for all your work on this webinar and for sharing your expertise, but also your personal lived experience. I think that was really, really generous of you. And I just want to, you know, tell you how much I appreciate it. And I'd like to also thank my colleagues behind the scenes from the TARC, Andy Capehart and Leslie McGee. And thank you all the participants, great comments, great questions. Thank you so much. We hope to see you next time on May 19th. We have APS practice models, types of staff specialization. And then to continue the conversation, again, if I didn't say it before, this is just the start of a conversation that's happening all over the field of APS and beyond. We are going to tackle a person-centered equitable practice around asking inclusive demographic questions, how to do it and why it matters on June 7th. And registration for both of those is out and about. If you have not seen it, next slide, please go ahead and contact us and we will get that registration out to you. Again, thank you so much to our presenters. Thank you to you all. Enjoy the rest of your day and we'll see you next time. Bye, everybody.
Bye, everyone.
See ya.